Hey everyone, Hayden Crabtree here, author of Skip to Flip. Today, this video is gonna be all about the five things you need to know to go out and buy and invest in your first piece of property. So the goal of this video is to teach you guys step by step, if you wanna get started, if you haven't bought any real estate yet, what is the one, two, three, four, and fifth thing you need to do to actually buy a piece of property. So my goal is to lay it out for you is an easy to understand format so you have no questions about it. So let's dive right in. Before we do, please hit that like button. Please subscribe to the channel so other people can see this, because my goal is to help 1,000 people buy their first rental property. And this video, this channel grows, it helps more people and it helps get me close to my goal, and I want to help you get close to your goal of financial freedom. Okay, so hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, and let's dive in. Let's do this. All right, step number one of what you need to know before you go out is, what is your goal? I want you guys to clearly define what your goal of making this investment is. If your goal is, hey, I want to buy one property, that is not a good enough goal. Your goal needs to be, I want to buy a property that makes 10% cash on cash. Or your goal could be something like, I want to buy a property that is going to produce $200 a month in cash flow. Or I want to buy a property that turns my $10,000 into $50,000 over the next 3 years. You need to define your goal. And really, there's two different types of goals that you could have in terms of real estate investing. Number one could be a cash flow goal. That's either a cash on cash metric or raw amount of cash flow. So how we determine our cash flow is our income minus our expenses gives us a number called our NOI. That's how commercial property is valued. That's not how residential property is valued. That's how commercial property is valued. And then after NOI, we have our debt service. And then we take our NOI minus our debt service, and that gives us our cash flow. So you could have a raw amount of cash flow you want the property to produce, either a year or a month. Or you could have a cash on cash percentage, meaning if it takes me $10,000 to buy this property and this property is gonna produce $1,000 a year, that'd be a 10% cash on cash. So this is a way to measure how well a property's performing based off of how much money you've put into it, okay? So if you have to put no money in the deal, then that's really hard to measure cash on cash because there is no amount to divide by. But if you do have to put cash on cash, or if you do have to put cash into a deal, it's gonna help you compare an apple to an orange and bring two deals together and say, which one of these is better? And now I'm comparing apples to apples. So super important to know. The other thing you wanna measure is, how fast is my wealth growing? So not a cash on cash number, but this is called the IRR. And you can do this by using an IRR calculator. You can do it in Excel. And I think I have a couple videos on how to do this on my channel. So go check out some of the other videos on my channel on what IRR is and how to calculate it. So before you dive in, before you start looking for property, you could waste a ton of time looking at property and never knowing whether it's gonna hit your goals or not. One way to measure this is gonna be to use a pro forma, okay? So I have on my channel a video on how to use a free pro forma. I created a pro forma, I give it away for free. It's a super basic one. I'll link that in the description. So you guys, if you're watching this video, you wanna understand how to calculate cash on cash or IRR or to analyze a deal, I'll link the video and I'll link the spreadsheet so you guys can go grab that absolutely free. And so the first thing to do is, what is your goal? Am I going for cash flow? Am I going for equity growth? What is my goal? Once you understand your goal, the next step is to go out and to actually find a property, okay? So I talk about this in my webinar. If you wanna watch this, how to buy your first investment property in the next 90 days, I talk about the different kinds of property. There's two different kinds of properties. There's on-market properties. This is when you go on Zillow, you go on Redfin, you go on Crexie, you go on LoopNet, and you're looking at properties that are actively for sale. These are called on-market deals. And in my opinion, on-market deals are never very good. The reason they're never very good is because the person selling the property is always gonna ask the highest possible price. Okay, the highest possible price that they think they can get, and then they're gonna go up some above that. They're hoping somebody, you know, who's dumb comes along and wants to pay them a really high price. It's great for the seller and it's not great for the buyer. These are on-market deals. Not a big fan of on-market deals. The other kind of deals are off-market deals. Okay, these are properties that are not actively for sale. Every property in the world is for sale, whether the owner knows it or not. But if you come along and you make an offer on a property that's not listed on these websites, that would be going after off-market deals. And normally off-market deals are a lot more preferential to somebody like me, somebody like you who wants to buy it, because what happens in an off-market deal is we work directly with the owner and we can find creative deals that are win-wins for both of us, instead of having a broker or an agent in between us that really limits the deal. Because brokers and agents All they care about is getting their commissions. They don't care about getting the best deal for both parties, which sometimes may involve creative financing or, you know, just a non-traditional purchase, which is good for both parties, but not good for the broker because they can't receive their commission until down the road, blah, 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 so on and so forth. So off-market deals is where we want to focus. So after you know your goal, you want to go out and you want to start looking for properties. You can do on-market if that's where you want to go and gain familiarity, start underwriting properties. But I'm just going to tell you now, the best deals you ever find are off-market deals. If you want to learn more about how to find off-market deals, tune into that webinar. The link's in the description below. It's absolutely free to go watch that webinar. I dive in how to find off-market deals and where they're at, okay? So after you find a deal, your third step is to make an offer on the property. So making an offer essentially is me putting myself out there, and this is the way it always works. Normally, you know, a buyer makes an offer to a seller. A seller doesn't make an offer to a buyer. A buyer, somebody like me, somebody like you, wanting to buy a property, we make the offer first, and we make the offer on a document called a letter of intent. Letter of intent. And what that means is, this is a letter of my intentions to purchase your property at these terms. So on a letter of intent, what I found works best is I want to write something that says, hey, here's who I am, here's why I want to buy your property, and then here's the terms at which I want to buy your property, right? So normally that's purchase price. So hey, I'll buy your property for $100,000. It's the terms. So I'll buy your property with 30 days of due diligence and 30 days to close after that. We'll get into due diligence in just a second. And then the other things that are going to go along with it is, how am I going to buy this property? I intend to use a bank to help me get a loan, and I'm going to put some money down. Or my intention is, I want to buy this property from you, and I want you, the owner, to finance some of the property for me, and I'm going to give you this. Or other, you know, aspects, terms that are going to be laid out is, hey, I intend to pay for all the closing costs on this, or I want you to split the closing costs with me. So a letter of intent is normally, I say normally because it can be binding, but normally a non-binding document, meaning here it is, here's my signature on it, but if you accept it, it doesn't really mean I can uphold this. It's just my intentions, letter of intent. It's my intentions to buy this property from you at these terms. So that's how you get the ball rolling whenever you want to go out and you want to buy a property, is through a letter of intent. So that's really the third step. First, know your goal. Second, find a property. Third, make an offer through a letter of intent on that property, okay? If you guys have any questions about letter of intents, drop me a comment. I'll be happy to answer them. And if you need one, you can shoot an email to me. My email should be on the screen right now. And so shoot me an email if you actually need a letter of intent document. I can help you guys out and get you one. Fourth part of the process is to put it under contract and do your due diligence, okay? So you have a letter of intent, which is non-binding, and then what you want to do is you want to move to a binding document. The binding document is called the contract. Okay, so this is a purchase and sale contract, a PSA, purchase and sale agreement. There's a couple different things, but normally we just call it the contract. And the contract is the formal, official, you know, here's how this deal is going to go down. Okay, so this is a binding document, meaning if a buyer and a seller, you know, enter into a contract together to purchase and sell a property, that should be upheld in court. And what that means is that if you say you're gonna buy a property from them and you don't, there's gonna be penalties that could be upheld in court. And normally those penalties are that you're gonna lose some money. To show that you're serious about buying a property, you're gonna have to put in earnest money into a deal, okay? Earnest money is a small percentage, normally call it 1-2% of the purchase price. So if we're gonna do a $100,000 property, we need to put in, let's call it $1,000 of earnest money when we first go under contract in this deal. And so that $1,000 is gonna be held by a third party normally an attorney or an escrow agent. And so that money is gonna be pretty much held on the table. If you don't perform your duties, then that $1,000 is gonna go to the seller as payment for you falling out of the contract. If you do uphold your end of the bargain, that $1,000 gets put towards you actually buying the property. So the point here is that once it's a binding document, there needs to be penalties if you don't uphold your end of the deal. So if you don't uphold your end of the deal, you lose the earnest money, but you need to make sure on the other end that the seller also upholds their end of the deal. And so what that looks like is a clause in which we call specific performance. What specific performance is it guarantees that if the seller of a property doesn't sell you that property per the terms of the contract, you can sue them to perform the specific duties of selling you that property in court. Now, you don't ever want to go there. It's just important to note that when you have a binding document, each party needs to have some sort of penalty if they don't perform what's agreed to in that contract. Otherwise, you know, it's a meaningless piece of paper. So once you put it under contract, then you have to do your due diligence. And what due diligence is before you actually own a property, but when you have it under contract, you're gonna go and you're gonna look at what is the physical condition of this building? Is it everything that I expected it to be? Is there anything in this that I need to repair that's gonna cost me, you know, more money than this deal is worth to me? If I put a house under contract for $100,000 and during my due diligence I found that it needs foundation work, it needs roof work, and it needs a new HVAC, you know, heating and air, then that may cost me, say, $15,000. Well, now I'm really buying this property for $115,000. Is this deal still viable? Does it still hit my goals? Do I still hit my metrics of what I want to hit, knowing what I now know about this property, but I didn't? So that's the purpose of due diligence, is to figure out everything about the property. You know, is it zoned correctly? Are there any environmental problems? What kind of physical work does it need? If it's a commercial property, you know, how much income is it producing? What are my upsides? What is the market like? Are all the contracts in place with the tenants? Is everything good on that perspective? Does it need any work? There's a lot to be done during this due diligence process, but this is the fourth part. Put it under contract and do your due diligence. Super, super important that your due diligence is done properly, and super important that you write your contract properly to make sure both people uphold their end of the deal. The fifth part of buying your first investment property is actually closing the deal. So closing the deal is where you are gonna go and you're actually gonna formally buy this at the end of the contract period, and then you're gonna execute on your business plan, whether that's renting it out, whether that's doing some rehab and renting it out for more money, whatever it means. The fifth part to actually close that deal. So closing is an entire process in and of itself. I'll tell you guys right now, there is no such thing as a smooth closing. It's very, very rare. Closing is an effort in and of itself. And the way I look at it is normally we have closing week, because if I think I'm gonna buy a property on Monday, it normally doesn't happen until Wednesday or Thursday. There's just always some sort of delays, always some sort of last minute problems, and you need to be prepared to bring endurance to the table whenever you are closing a property, because it's never as simple and straightforward as it seems. There's so many documents that fly around. You know, there's so many different people involved, whether it's title companies, closing attorneys, bankers wiring money, you wiring money, sellers and buyers coming to the table to both sign. It's just this big coordination process that you will not learn how to do until you actually go through and you can experience it. Now, if you have any questions, if you're closing a property, you have any questions, I'm happy to help answer those. Drop a comment here. I'll help you answer those questions. But just know that this is going to be an entire process in and of itself to actually just signing the paperwork and closing that deal. And then after that, you need to go out and you need to execute. So again, I'll say it. The five steps to buying your first property: know your goal, find a property, make an offer through a letter of intent, put it under contract and do your due diligence. And then number five is close the deal and execute the business plan. So I hope this was super helpful for you guys. If you have any questions about any of that, again, I'll link some resources to kind of dive further in depth on this video in the description here. So go check that out. If you have any questions, drop me a comment. If you like this video, if it was helpful, do me a favor, share it with a friend. Somebody else could see this, help somebody else get closer to financial freedom, give them the confidence to go out and actually buy that deal. And if you guys want to dive more into the specifics of how to value deals, how real estate works, grab my best-selling book, Skip the Flip, absolutely free, PDF or audiobook, links in the description. Again, hope you enjoyed this video. Smash the like button, check out some other videos on my channel, and I'll see you next time.